Okay guys, hey, what's up? This is like something I record pre my intro recording. This me basically just saying that my apologies for the lack of upload, my apologies for the late upload as well. I was planning on battling Sasha Saturday, but I didn't make my own deadline, which I said, so I got called up to play sport because someone fell out with an injury and yeah, they called me up, so I played sport and then stuck around for a little bit too long. So apologies to you guys, apologies to Sasha, my opponent this week. So I wanted to record this last night as well, but I was slightly intoxicated, like that's not uncommon for me, but and also it wasn't really the time around the house to do it because everyone was asleep, so I didn't want to wake anyone up, so that's why I'm doing it this morning. But yeah, my apologies aside, good luck and have fun watching this video. Hey guys, what's up? Today I'm gonna face Sasha from the Swansea Cities. I'm sorry for making weird faces and stuff, and yeah, I am just slightly intoxicated and slightly intoxicated. Let's keep it at that. I had a family kind of thing, and most of my family are even bigger alcoholics than I am, so obviously a lot of beer passed through my system, and obviously I'm quite a bit intoxicated, to say the least. So yeah, also had a great party last night, which I don't remember anything from, so shit. Anyway, that's my personal life, so that's not something you probably care about. But yeah, I'm facing Sasha this week, Sasha from the Swansea Cities, Swansea City, I'm sorry. And Sasha is actually undefeated like me. He's 5-0, I mean. And of course, because we're facing week 6, so he's 5-0, and yeah, he's doing pretty well. He has so far been undefeated, so of course after this week he won't be undefeated anymore. But basically, Sasha, I don't know, I'm actually not feeling Sasha too much, and that's not because I'm slightly intoxicated, just because I know Sasha, and Sasha is actually, he's a decent battler, but he kind of overlooks things really easily, and that's something I can definitely make like kind of abuse of, if that's the correct word to say, because I might be fair that I'm using the fucking wrong word. So yeah, I helped build Sasha teams in the past, especially for the first 3 weeks, 4 weeks maybe even, because like last season he didn't start off too well, and he asked me for his help last season. And he also again asked me for his help this season, so I was generously offering help this season as I did with more people in the GPC, building their teams and helping to build their teams at least. But yeah, basically Sasha is on his own this week, I think. Anyway, my apologies for the cut, someone was walking upstairs, and yeah, I'm not home alone tonight, so yeah, I'm sorry. I'm gonna have to pause it multiple times, hopefully not, but more than likely. And yeah, anyway, today facing Sasha. Sasha is has a good team, as you can see on the screen. Gyarados, Scissor, Mega, Titor, Mesprit, Zapdos, Dragon, Slowking, Hypnoly, Sandslash, Delphox, and Moomis. Sandslash, pretty surprisingly, is the MVP from this season. And yeah, it's 11 kills, 0 deaths. And mostly because he's running the Centaurus variant, and yeah, definitely a scary mon to face up against, actually. Anyway, it's scary, but my team actually holds up pretty well. I've got a lot of physical bulk, which can manage against Sandslash, so I'm not fearing it too much to the extent that other people might fear it. And yeah, we'll see how I fare against Sasha if he decides to bring it, because I actually don't even think he will. It will basically only fuck up his differential, so yeah. Anyway, also you might have seen, I switched in Kecleon for Grumble, as you can see in the transfers here. This is actually not for this week yet, this is actually for next week. Basically, I had a deal with Sasha, the guy I'm playing this week. Grumble, I could only use Grumble for 3 weeks. And that's for week 4, 5 and 6, so this week I can still use Grumble. I did not decide to use it on my team because just out of respect for Sasha. Actually, I have all of my mods against all of my mods I have on my team have a very very good use against his team, so I had to choose between all 11 mods which one to use, and I figured that Grumble wasn't in the top 6 that were useful against his team, and so yeah. Basically, Kecleon is available for me for next week, since next week, and for the playoffs, so yeah. Anyway, this week, Sonic City, like I said, his team is pretty threatening. You can see it on the screen, because I don't want to like name it all again. And I built the team myself, of course, because that's how I roll. I built it this morning, after being very, very hungover. Actually, I wasn't hungover at all. I had a great party last night, but I don't remember anything from it, so... Luckily, it wasn't hangover, so I was able to build my teams pretty normally. But yeah, it still bothers me. I don't remember anything from the party because it wasn't a normal party, but just a barbecue. So yeah, it's pretty awkward that happened. So hopefully, no one heard that from my family, but we'll see. If they did, then I'm fucked. Anyway, onto my team. Give me one quick. So this is my team I'm bringing versus Sasha. Again, you can see his team on the screen right here. And basically, noticing his team, his flaws in his team are that he does not have a heal builder or a Romity user. So I can definitely status his team all around without him being able to heal it off. As well, he does have healing with Mesprit, but that's about it. That's his only thing. So that's something that my team has built around this week. Also, his fastest mod is Delphox, which is base 104 speed, meaning that. Quite a big deal of my team at speed, it being Cobalion, Mega Absol, Arceus. So a few months on my team at speed, unless he has a Scarfer. Weirdly enough, I've only bred one of those 3 months that I just named. But yeah, also he has three quad weaknesses in Tyranitar, which is unable to run a Chopo Berry or any other berry. So I can definitely just like, I don't know, just a little bit of fighting type move and he won't survive it. Unless he's really bulky, which it definitely might be, because I know how Sasha likes to run his sets, and Bulky Titor is definitely one of them. Also, Scissor with the quad weakness to fire, and Gyarados with the quad weakness to electric. And yeah, basically a flaw, I don't know, it's not necessarily a flaw on his end, and not necessarily a flaw on my end, but I talk to him a lot, and I help him build teams, so I know his flaws, and I know what sets he likes to run on his mods, despite them being particularly good versus my team or versus any team. He likes to just decide to go with defensive Gyarados, for example, even though offensive Gyarados might be a lot better. So that could work in my favor, knowing that what sets he's gonna bring, and also could work against me if he had help from someone else that said, well, offensive Gyarados does a lot better, so why not use that? Also, for example, he likes to run offensive Senseless, so I have not really built around him using a defensive Senseless. So one of those it could definitely work against me using this knowledge if he like changes up his whole tactic versus me. So yeah. And yeah, that's basically a few of his flaws that I could definitely exploit this match at least. Of course, once he gets Crumble back, he does have a heal battle. So yeah, maybe not for the. For the playoffs, if he decides to make it, because he's facing the number 3 next week, Yuzi, which I just won against last week, the Bangladesh. So they're fighting for the second spot, and at least if I win this, of course, because if I lose this, I might be able to get knocked out of the playoffs. Still, even after 5 win streak, I still might lose, so that's definitely very useful for me to get this victory today. Basically, the team I think Sasha is gonna bring is Scissor, because Scissor has a very strong bullet punch that does damage against my Arceus and my Cure, which I think he definitely fear. I think he's gonna bring Tyranitar, because Tyranitar is bulky, and I think he's gonna run bulky Tyranitar. And it's a good check to, just for him to good hazard setter and good check to, Cure him and maybe. I don't know, Arceus, I guess. Yeah, I just think he's gonna bring Tyranitar just because he sets up rocks and he can just hit dark moves and fighting moves and his coverage all around. So yeah, I think he's gonna Titor. Also Mesprit, because Mesprit is very, very versatile, so I definitely fear Mesprit. It's one of his few mods that I fear. He could be Scarf, he could be like a mixed attacker just to damage like most of my team, like a sort of wall breaker ish. Also, I think he's gonna bring Zapdos, even though I have a Lantern, which is a crucial member of my team to take on offensive Zapdos' variants. I think he's gonna bring some kind of defense Zapdos, and that's kind of what I built my team on, with defense, with like offensive mounts on my team that were able to deal with Zapdos as defensive mode. Also, I think he's going to bring Delphox, because Delphox is his fastest mode on his team. And I think Delphox is going to, especially if it's like Specs, maybe even if it's Scarf, it's going to put in a lot of work against my team. So I think he's going to bring Delphox, definitely. And last but not least is going to be Amoongus. And Amoongus is not the best, but also, if played well, it's definitely something I don't want to see, because Amoongus is actually pretty good. So I think he's gonna bring Amoongus as well. He has also the potential to bring stuff like Gyarados for the Intimidate and defensive mode variant. Dirtigan, because Dirtigan, I don't think I've ever used Dirtigan. And I don't really expect it to use for him to use it versus me, because my team is like pretty offensive. But he might have to definitely have like a use for a defensive one or for like assault as well. So yeah. And also Slowking. Slowking could actually be a pretty good monk versus me. At least versus the team I'm bringing, because I'm not bringing stuff like... okay, my scrimmage is not like, but I'm not bringing stuff like Lantern or Tangela, just the heads up. So yeah, I think Slowking might be something he would bring. Anyway, onto the team I brought versus him. You can all see it hopefully like this. I brought as first Manaphy, and Manaphy is a Rindo Berry because I fear Energy Ball or Slash Grass Knot from Delphox mainly, because that's the one thing that outspeeds my Manaphy. And also if he's like Assault Vest Amoongus, I can definitely set up a toggle on it and just continue to Ice Beam it to death or Surf or Hit Barlet, depending on how low it is on the damage shit and how shit. So this guy is pretty useful because it actually OKOs a lot of steam after one tilt low, and it outspeeds almost everything. The only thing that doesn't outspeed it are Scarfers and Hitmonlee if it's Jolly, which I don't think it will be, but if it is Jolly then it outspeeds Manaphy, and also of course the Delphox like I just mentioned. Next up is Archeops. Archeops does not have an item. Archeops is an acrobatic U-turn Stone Edge Roost set. So double step, U-turn, and roost. It basically outspeeds everything on his team. That's as simple as it is. And also, acrobatics is going to do huge damage to almost everything on his team, and everything that acrobatics does not hit, Stone Edge does. So stuff like Zapdos are not a counter to Archeops. And U-turn for momentum, if like some sort of stuff on his team is not weakened after the point where two acrobatics is knocked out or one acrobatics is knocked out, and yeah, just U-turn to preserve Archeops and make it a clean late game, which I think it might do. Next up is Kyurem Black, and I'm using a pretty bulky Kyurem Black, not fully bulky invested, but it's actually speed investment to outspeed any variant of Scissor, because I wanna know if Scissor is like a setup or defensive or Choice Scarf, since I know he has definitely used Choice Scarf in the past before, so. It's base 108, no not base 108, it has 108 speed investment. My apologies. And yeah, and that's basically just precision, like I said. Carries the moves Fusion Bolt, Ice Power and Earth, Ice Beam and Earth Power. Fusion Bolt of course for the Gyarados mainly, and also for kind of a lot of esteem actually. It hits Scissor for good damage, it hits Mesprit for example for good damage, everything for good damage. Ice Beam is for the Dragon types and for everything else that's used to Ice Beam, obviously. And also it's just a very very strong step that can definitely just fire up, unless he brings Scissor of course, because Scissor is decent switching. But still it does good damage against Scissor as well. So Earth Power, I could have used Hidden Power Fire for the Scissor, expecting it to be a counter to Kyurem Black, which I kinda still wanna do. But he also has Tyranitar, which is incredibly bulky, and yeah, I think he's gonna use it versus me, and I switch him to it pretty difficultly, so I think he's gonna bring Titor, and I wanna be able to hit it up for some good damage with Earth Power. So yeah, that's why I bring Earth Power over Hidden Power Fire, especially since stuff like Manaphy can is easily able to set up against Scissor and can also get the serve after plus 3. Also, I just have counters in the next few months I'm bringing. One of them being Covergus with Culver Berry for stuff like knockoff Scissor, of course. It's Will-O-Wisp Hex, Rest, Sleep Dog. Pretty much specially defensive because it obviously has a lot of physical defense already. I do have some investment in physical defense, as you can see, because most of his team is physically offensive, so it can check most of his team this way. Like the only thing on my team that it's really weak is Ghost and Guard types. So for example, Aspect Shadowball is definitely gonna be annoying for configurators to deal with. But yeah, we'll see if he's dead separate or something else. If he's anything but Scarf, then Archives can take it up, which is an Acrobatics or just a Storm Edge. I had knockoff on it at first, but I figured it might be Cobblerberry since it's so easy to run Cobblerberry on like Psychic types or Ghost types, so yeah. Anyway, that's the Cobblerberry configure this with these moves. Rest of the crucial longevity and just to be as annoying as possible. And yeah, next up is Mew. Mew is actually somewhat different than the other Stallbreaker Mew that I'm bringing usually. It's again Cobblerberry because Cobblerberry. It's this time it's toxic, a little bit knockoff and roost. It's not taunt, no. That's basically because, like I said, he doesn't have any heal bearers or armor therapy users, so taunt is not that useful. I don't think. Also, I don't need to prevent him from statusing me, or I don't need to prevent him defogging or whatever, or setting up, or I don't know. I am not fearing it too much, so I'm using Toxic a little bit as knockoff and roost. Toxic for to hit up anything like, I mean, Zapdos or whatever is definitely nice and toxic, and even Delphox if it's a switch in or if it's just in on my Mew is definitely nice to have Toxic. So I'm learning Toxic overdraw this time. And yeah, hopefully it's gonna pay off because, like I said, he doesn't have any heal bearers or armor therapy users. So. Pretty specially defensive, the speed is to outspeed guaranteed Gyarados. A max speed infested Jolly Gyarados with like substitute, which he definitely can run. I don't think he will, but I fear the worst. And I'm running this set just for that. And yeah, I can well lose before it actually starts setup. So that's why I'm running this speed of Gyarados. Also, with outspeed stuff like Mesh Pit, of course, unless it's corrupt. So it's always nice to know if this Mesh Pit is corrupt or not. And yeah, basically knock off to hit up again the Delphox to weaken the rest of his team and to just annoy him and break his I don't know, win conditions even possibly. Like, if he has a Scarf, then I might knock off his Scarf and it might be rendered useless for the rest of the game. And last but not least, it is Safety Goggles New Queen. Like I said, he does have Amoongus. I have for Among Us I have two things. One of them being Nidoqueen, the other one being Cofagricus. Nidoqueen is obviously a nice switch and it can easily Ice Beam or Flamethrower the Among Us to death, weakening it slightly. Just like over 50% of the nice to good kill. But yeah, also Earth Power for the Titar for the I don't know, even for Mesprit because yeah, Mesprit obviously doesn't have Levitate, so yeah. I don't know what I'm saying. And of course Stealth Rocks, because I didn't have any Stealth Rock on my team yet, so that's my Stealth Rocks. I could have chosen to go with T-Spikes, but like except he does have Among Us, so I don't think T-Spikes are going to be as useful, and I can probably drop Toxics faster and better with Mew, making them more useful because the Toxic is better than Potion, in my opinion, versus Sashi this time. And also to hit up Zapdos and his Pokemon, so yeah. Anyway, this is my team. The Nidoqueen set might still change, because I'm not sure yet what set I want to run on Nidoqueen. I might make it definitely more physically bulky, or I might just keep it like this and see what happens, so we'll see. Anyway, thanks for watching this part, and hopefully see you soon when I'm facing Sasha in, well, somewhere between now and 3 hours, so I'm definitely not sobering up before that. So me being drunk is definitely going to be a thing, so yeah, thank you for watching this part, and see you soon.
Alright, and we are with the replay. This is, like you can see, the next morning, which you can hopefully see, in the first minute or so of the video. But yeah, playing Sasha, Swansea City, the Swans, and he leads out with, at least let's first look at this team. Basically, he has 5 to 6 months, I expected. He doesn't have Mesprit, but he has Dorican over Mesprit, which is kinda okay. That means that I don't have to fear a Scarf Mesprit, and the only possible Scarf he really has is this Delphox. As Titar is Mega, Scissor is not a problem if it's Scarfed. Durdagon is really not common as Scarfed. He could have been Scarfed, would be pretty cool, but nah. And Zapdos, he doesn't like to run Scarf Zapdos. So if he did run Scarf Zapdos, I would have taken advantage of it other way. But heads up, he is not Scarf Zapdos, and I'm gonna bank on that in the video as well. So. He leads out with Delphox, ended up with Kyurem Black. Basically, Kyurem had the best matchup versus everything on his team. He had two possible leads, in my opinion, were Titar and Delphox. And Titar would have been a good lead for him, at least the matchup. And Delphox would have been like my best matchup versus, because Delphox can just pop anything on the team that's just slightly weakened, and basically Kieran Black is the only thing that can comfortably live one hit and do some good damage back, especially if it's specs. If it's not specs, then more of my mons can let the hit, but yeah. Turns out he searches out on the first turn, and not wanting to risk the Delphox getting damage or even Oko, depending on my set. As I go for the Earth Power on the Scissor, Scissor is not especially defensive, I can see from this damage. So that's very nice. He makes a double switch out into Amoongus, not sure what he predicted, but I'm gonna go into my Clefairy Kiss. It's a tremendous counter to Scissor. And he goes for the Foul Play. And Foul Play is not the worst move on his part, because he gets rid of my Berry. Which can definitely help his Titor later on in the match. Or the anything else that just wants to rely on their move. But yeah, I go for a double Will-O-Wisp, expecting him to switch out, as he cannot really touch me with Sludge Bomb or Foul Plays, and he also lost his Regenerator, so I figured he would switch out before he was getting too weakened. He switched out weirdly, at least in my opinion. Also, I could have I got some damage on the Delphox, much needed damage on the Delphox with my Hex, and then he switches out into Moongus again, and then into Zapdos, which is kind of weird. I feel he might have expected me to make double switches, but yeah. Anyway, now I'm in with Nidoqueen versus Dredigon, and we just exchange rocks, and I get an Ice Beam up on the Dredigon because I was already switched in Nidoqueen, of course. Ice Beam does a good chunk of damage to Dredigon. He decides to save it and Sekka's Amoongus instead, which manages to get a little bit of damage off against me, as he was, I think, Assault Vest Max PDF Amoongus, as he, like he said, to check stuff like Nidoqueen and Ice Beams from Kyurem and even Manaphy. So well preparation is on his end, but yeah, it goes down first thing. Now this is a threat. As you can see, this man gets up DDs with Titor. I expect him to revenge kill me with Delphox, as Delphox can obviously outgo Nidoqueen easily, but yeah, Delphox only has one more switch in and Steldrox after at least this, because it's 45%. So he decided to go for a different plan, and he decided to risk his early game, late game win condition against me. As you can see, I did not consider checking the Titor too much. I somewhat did and I somewhat didn't. I mean, I knew that his offensive, his Titor and his offensive stats could do a lot of damage to me, and his defense stats weren't as useful. But yeah, a Dragon Dancing Titor is not something I figured would be a problem to me, and luckily it turns out that it's not the biggest problem to me, because he does not have EQ, he does have Crunch, because he obviously needs to prepare from the whole team, and EQ did not like put a he didn't have enough space for to put EQ on his moveset, so he went for the Crunch, and Crunch, as you will see, is not taking me down. And it wasn't a roll or anything. Actually, this Crunch damage was a near max roll. The max roll was 72.3%, and he got 72.1%. And also, my Earth Powers also were rolls, I think, were 42.5 to 49.5%. So both rolls were in my favor, as Nidoqueen takes down this fucking Titor. And Nidoqueen is pretty useful, as it seems. So yeah, Titor down, big threat gone. But unfortunately, Nidoking is gonna go down the next turn. Two bullet punch. He could have overpredicted with Scissor. Of course, he didn't, because there was no reason to. And there was no reason for me to save Nidoking anyway. So, and expecting him to be somewhat bandit or something of likes, I'm gonna go into Manaphy and set up Tilgo. Yeah, even if he's not bandit, it's not the biggest deal. I basically get a kill either way with Manaphy here. And like I said, I predict him to not be a Scarf Zapdos or not be a Max Speed Zapdos. I predict him just to be a normal Zapdos. If he is especially defensive Zapdos, this crit on the Yatsuberry might have mattered. But this is one of the things where well, let's I don't know his moveset, I don't know his spread, but let's say if it's Max 248 HP, 252 Spidef with a Spidef nature. The roll was 45.6% till over 55% or something. So the roll was definitely in my favor, big time. But like I said, I was a little bit intoxicated last night, and I was really confident in this match. So I forgot that just going for Surf would have been enough to KO the Zapdos from Deadrains, because yeah, obviously Surf, he cannot have a berry to weaken the Surf strength, and Surf is easily a KO from Deadrains, so Ice Beam was just there if he was max SPDF and at full health, so yeah. Which was almost that Alco, of course, after the plus 3 special attack. Was definitely the roll was still in my favor if he was at full health, like 100%. So yeah, anyway, let's just continue. Manaphy stays alive for one more turn, and it can actually soak up this Psychic from the Delphox easily. It turns out to be Specs Delphox, and he doesn't go for an Energy Ball or whatever, because he knows how I prepare, and he knows I have a Rindle Berry on Manaphy. And I did, so that's well thought out on your end. Didn't matter for him too much, because he's gonna go for the Bullet Punch, as it does not knock out Manaphy, as he turns out not to be Bandit. And then I switch out Manaphy, fearing the Sucker Punch, and I wanna have the 5-0 victory, so I go into Macrophagus to deal the remaining damage against the Rodigan. As yes, as that is the game. It's a comfortable 5-0 victory in my favor. And yeah, the Swansea City, he had a terrible matchup against me. I knew I. That's why I went so confidently last night. I knew I was gonna win regardless of what crazy shit he wanted to bring. I was really confident in my matchup, and only Titor could have definitely brought me some trouble, because I didn't prepare for it too much. But Manaphy was still easily healthy enough to live the hit, and also had Cobra Barry Mew, which could definitely outspeed any variant of. Well, it actually couldn't anymore. If he had Substitute, he could have. Prevented me from Will-O-Wisping him, and he could have swept me. I guess that's something that he could have done. So if he manages next week to reach the playoffs, I will consider that, and I will put in the thought of him running DD Substitute next time. So yeah, for now, thanks for watching, and I'm still undefeated, and next week I'm facing Brett from the LA Latios, I think, Los Angeles Latios, yeah. So we'll see if I can keep my undefeated streak going. I will quickly show you the spreadsheet and how everything is doing, because again, I'm the latest to upload, so you've obviously watched everyone else's videos. If not, then this is the last time to stop the video. Welcome back. So yeah, the Division A and the Division B league tables are both up on your screen. And as you can see, currently I am, together with Natsu, the only undefeated team. I defeated both Bungalow Wise and Swansea City in the last 2 weeks, making them no longer undefeated. And yeah, oh, also the Swansea City has to drop one place to the third spot, and the Bungalow Wise to the second spot, but I will do that in a quick second. So yeah, for now, it's really close between who's gonna make the playoffs. It's really crazy, actually, because these two guys are facing each other, the Swansea City and the Bengal Wash, for the second spot. That's the only spot for players, of course, because no one won the mid-season tournament. And here in Division D, it's actually really close too. These three teams all have a very good chance of making the playoffs. Everyone else doesn't have any opportunity anymore. Basically, the Toronto Torteros are playing Nacho. If they decide to win, and if they decide to win big time, they can definitely still make the playoffs. If, for example, they win more than Dave does, or if they win more than 3 differential than Pierre does. It's a tough task for him, because it's against Nacho, and Nacho has an incredibly good team, which will only get defeated by my team in the hopefully finals. Yeah. That's like the only place I expect to face Nacho, because because I basically cannot. I technically can drop to second place, but technically I can, I guess. If he wins 6-0 and I lose 6-0, or if he wins 5-0 and I lose 5-0, I still lose. I still get the second spot. But if I win anything, or if I win, or if I lose any with any less than that, then I'm still safe, basically. What was I going to say? Oh yeah, and these two guys facing each other. To as well for the C and Fishy restrooms, so that's really crazy too. That's pretty, yeah. It's really funny that all of these teams face each other in the final week for the final playoff spot. So it's really crazy, and really, it's really the game is on for their team. So yeah, we'll see if slash how they manage to to prepare for each other and how they manage to of whoever manages to reach the second playoff spot, because that is more than likely going to be my opponent for the playoffs. And I expect it to be David or Pierre, of course, because Omega faces Nacho. And I think I'd prefer facing Pierre. Yeah, that would be my... Don't know if Pierre's gonna win, because both have their ups and their like the pros and cons in team building and in playing and in their teams. But I hope to face Pierre. And if I face David, of course I will still win. But I think Pierre has a... I guess more challenging team I want to face, so... David, of course, has a really strong team as well, and I actually don't want to face it, so that's why I want Pierre to win. So, and Pierre didn't make the last season by getting very unlucky, so that's why I kind of hope Pierre will win this time, so he manages to reach the playoffs. And for Yuji Sasha, I think Yuji is going to win, my honest opinion. Sasha has... I think Yuji has a better team than Sasha does, and Sasha is, of course... pretty respectable that he got so far with this team he has here, but yeah, I think Yuji will prevail. Yeah. Anyway, this was it. This was the behind the scenes on the league table shit and stuff. And yeah, I will. I'm basically secured for my playoff spot, which is fantastic. Same with Nacho. But I will definitely go for the undefeated streak, of course, facing Brett Los Angeles next week, as he is unable to reach the playoffs at this point. So for him, it's his only task to get some experience to obviously stop me from having a win streak and going undefeated for the whole season. So thanks for watching. Leave a like if you enjoyed, and leave a comment, because I want you to know. I want you to vote, or not necessarily vote, but I want you to choose a nickname for my Keklian, which is my recent transfer. Hopefully the page loads, because that's something that would definitely help. As you can see, Keklian is the new member to my team, and Keklian needs a new name. And I need you to vote for it, or need you to put suggestions in, and to what nickname is nice and good for Keklian. So, thanks for watching this part. Leave your suggestions in the comment section below, and leave a like if you enjoyed, and see you next time when I'm facing the Los Angeles Latios. See you guys!